गोविंद नाम संकीर्तनम गोविंदा गोविंदा सद्गुरु महाराज की जय। हरे रामेति कृष्णेति नाम संकीर्तनम सदा लोकक्षेमाय कुर्वन्तं प्रेमितं सद्गुरुं भजे। कलये सुन्दराकारं सदैकप्रियदर्शनं अज्ञाननाशकं देवं सद्गुरुं मुरलीधरम्। कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नन्दनाय च नन्दगोपकुमाराय गोविन्दाय नमो नमः। नाम संकीर्तनं यस्य सर्वपापप्रणाशनं प्रणामो दुःखशमनः तन्नमामि हरिं परं। श्रीहरये नमः श्रीहरये नमः श्रीहरये नमः। सद्गुरु महाराज की जय। The immense blessings of our beloved Guru Maharaj, Maharanyam Shri Shri Muralidhara Swamiji. Today we will take a very special chapter, something very close to our beloved Guru Maharaj's heart. It is there in the 11th canto. The 11th canto of Bhagavatam is an interesting and an intriguing and an immensely useful guidebook, not only for our religious life per se, though I don't like to divorce religion from day-to-day living. I'm sure you get what I'm saying. A religious life in the sense that the life in the puja room type of a thing, or life when I am in the satsang type of a thing. It gives some tremendous insights into how do I be a better person? How do I succeed well in my life? How do I not get manipulated or distracted by what's happening outside, either online or in bone and flesh with other people, etc. And it gives me a tremendous perspective of how I be me so that I can actually succeed in my life. Okay. In that, I will take a small little sample. I'm going to discuss 11th canto, chapter 23. So let me give you a small overview before we go to the sloka so that we can appreciate the significance and the immensity of the sloka. We all know that, you know, there is something called blame, right? There is always something called blame. And blame, if you want to see it in a little fun way, is an enticing invitation for us to be lame. Okay. Be lame in spite of the wonderful gift of feet to stand our ground and to stand for something. Blame helps us to actually become lame. And blame, actually, if you take the B off, it says be lame, right? And blame basically means that I am distracted from my life. And instead of me trying to run my life for a few minutes, or for some it may be a few days, or for some it may be the whole life, we are mistaking something else to run my life. Huh? And this is something which I have spoken to your parents whenever I visited their city in US or in Muscat or in Chennai or wherever. We have done some programs on happiness. And this is something which stuck as something very significant to me. So I generally share with my friends and others. There are three businesses in this world, right? There is my business, and there is your business, and there is God's business. And of course, God runs all the businesses, but he has given a delegation a little bit for me also. It's a joint venture between God and me for what I need to run my life. So here, when I mistake my business to be your business or somebody else's business or God's business, that's when I get into this lame business of being a blamer. I hope such a word exists. So blaming comes when I get a little mixed up between running my life as my business versus trying to see my life somebody else's business, or trying to see my life as God's business. And that's when the person becomes fatalistic. And what is true surrender is something else. We will see that in a few weeks from now. That's something a little more deeper and intense. But right now, let us look at some practical aspects of how we manage to get ourselves distracted or manipulated in our life and hence lose the joy and vitality of life. So here, blame means I mix up. Actually, my business of living, making decisions, making the choices, and I mix it up with either somebody else's business or I just make it God's business. Let me give you an example. The typical example is, you know, summer in Chennai can be hot, right? So when a person sits down sweating and the person complains, huffing and puffing, it's so hot in Chennai. Now, the weather is not my business, you see, at least the weather right now. Maybe I can reduce my carbon footprint and all that and impact the weather in a positive way, in a small way in future. But right now, whatever weather is out there is certainly not, you know, my business. But the discomfort I feel because of this incremental or this adverse weather is my business, right? That's certainly what I'm feeling. So when I am trying not to use an I statement or I can statement or I need to statement, and rather I look at it is so hot today, it is so stuffy today, I am pushing a chance of running my life as my business into somebody else's business. And that's when blame comes in, right? And I'm not saying that our life is an island. Of course. We depend on people, we depend on nature for our life, all that is fine. But the moment I take my eyes off what I can do at this present moment is the moment I allow blame to enter into my mind. You see? So the simple question I need to ask is, can I switch on a fan? Or there is a power problem, can I take a sheet of paper or sheet of thick cardboard to fan myself? That's all. So now the business to make it my business, the right choice, the right decision, the right thought processes, how do I make myself cooler? So do you see there is a my and I there? Instead of saying the weather is bad or my father didn't fix the air conditioner or I don't know. The electricity department of Tamil Nadu is not doing its job properly. All that is not my business. But reminding my dad to fix an air conditioner is my business, you see? And writing a small memo or a request or a complaint letter to an electricity board is my business. The moment I lose sight of what I can do or I need to do is the moment I stop living and I start blaming. Because now I look at the cause of my suffering and the solution to be my suffering, of my suffering to be somebody else's business. I may need to influence others to get my sufferings. For example, I am hungry. I may have to request my mother or father to fix something for me as a breakfast. Now that's still my business. But to blame that the, you know, the food was not served on time, etc., is running somebody else's business, you see. And so, unless I try to fix something in me, which runs the business of my life, and not take the focus off that, I would completely get into a blame game. Now, why I said all that is, this is a perfect introduction to this incredible set of slokas, highest of spirituality, and it is also the greatest of plain common sense to lead a life responsibly, to lead our life blame-free, excuse-free, which means to understand the reason for what is happening to me, the primary reason is my mind, and the secondary reason which is fueling my mind could be others, right? So here very beautifully, there is this person from Ujjain. The ancient name for Ujjain, which is right now somewhere in, I think, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh area, the border area. And Ujjain is a very ancient town. You have a lot of heritage places in Ujjain. And incidentally, that's the place where our Bhagavan Sri Krishna went to college. That's where Sandipani established his university there. Sandipani, who was Krishna's guru, originally was from Kashi. He's a native of Kashi, but he settled in Ujjain, called Avanti. And that's where he had the Sandipini ashram. And that's why today the Indian government opened a wonderful Sanskrit university in the name of Sandipani, because it is Krishna's guru who lived in that area. So here is a story which Krishna himself tells Uddhava Swami. Possibly the story must have picked up when he was in school or college. Apart from the fact that Krishna is omniscient, that he is all-knowing, just talking in a very, what do you call, the banal plane. Maybe while he was in his school with Sudama and Sandipani, somebody must have given the local, you know, legends, or not legend, legend never happened. The local history, can I say that, of people who lived there. So there was this a person who was an extremely a miserly person. He not only made life miserable for people around him, he also made life miserable for himself. That's the problem with misers, you see. They not only make it miserable for others, they make it miserable for themselves also. Not even spending enough wealth on basic needs, etc. So everybody despised him, and the times were not good for him, and so totally he was overthrown. All his wealth was taken by his relatives, and he was thrown to the street. And when he was going around as a mendicant or as a beggar, he had this wonderful insight into a true nature of stuff. He became what is called as a realized soul. And people started ill-treating him, unspeakably ill-treating him. And he had this wonderful stroke of realization where he says, I won't blame anybody for the suffering which I am undergoing. And the true cause of suffering is not all these people. So that's the 11th canto. This sloka is so empowering because it is so easy and so emotionally comfortable for us to blame somebody else for what we are undergoing, right? And that's not responsible living. And we will see a little more of it, a little more depth of it in the weeks to come. Responsible living is not blaming, but trying to find out how do I make my life better by influencing others or by asking the help or service of others. And I am the one who is responsible for my well-being, in the sense that even if I am dependent on others, I make every business statement as what I can do business, instead of what they should have done, or they ought to have done, or they must have done, or they could have done, etc. That's absolutely a foolish way, irresponsible way to live. The moment you shift the reason for my emotions is somebody else is a very a dicey way of living. So here, this Avanti Brahmana, the dvija, that's how it starts, dvija uvAcha, has this realization. At times when people undergo some extreme suffering, some of them, not all of course, very rarely, a few of them who are blessed, obviously, by some sadhu or a guru or Bhagavan, they get this wonderful flash of realization. Adversity, as Swami Vivekananda says, is a greater teacher than even prosperity and good times. So here the dvija is vocally voicing his own inner realization. He's saying, nAyam jano me sukha duhkha hetu na devatA atma graha karma kalaha manaha param kAraNam amananti samsArachakram parivartayed. Incredible sloka. Remember I told you three things: my business, your business, and the rest of the world business, okay, or God's business, or nature's business. And since it's the area of spirituality, Bhagavatam divides God's business into many more branches. So he's saying that the reason for sukha and dukkha hetu. Hetu means kAraNam. Hetu means reason. nAyam jano me, he's saying, these people who insulted him are not the cause of my sorrow, devatA, not some deity. Atma, graha, karma, kala, all these is in the bundle of nature, God's business. It is not because of karma. It is not because of friction of planets. It is not because he's in a bad time. These are not the cause of my joy or sorrow. This is the highest realization. We can take our time to get there, but we need to get there eventually. Whether it is 16 or 60 or 120 years of our life, we need to get there somewhere. And this is the grandest truth. Manav param kAraNam Amananti. The reason for joy or sorrow, as our scriptures declare. You see, that's the beauty of our scriptures. It does not want us to be even dependent on it in the long run. It wants to be like a training wheel. You understand training wheels, right? When we try to get into a bike. The training wheels are there for us to find our own balance in a driving endeavor. The moment I find my balance, the training wheel says, I'm not required. Take me off. Don't keep me on for the rest of your life. Believe it or not, our religion, which is based on Shruti. Shruti means Vedas, Upanishads, etc. And Smriti, which is all these dharma, dharma rules, our Purana, Itihasas, etc. They say, even we don't want to interfere with your life beyond a point. Once you have the realization, we become redundant. Can you show me one scripture apart from our Vedas who boldly declare you don't have to rely on me the moment you realize? You see? That's the beauty, that's the genuineness, that's the amount of empowerment our scriptures want to give us. So here scriptures say the cause for your suffering, the joy, the sorrow, all the emotions, etc., the experiences, if you can say, is mana. It is the mind alone. And it is the mind which sets all these wonderful play in motion. So don't blame others. You may have to influence others. You may have to request others. You may have to even intimidate others if required. Right? In practical terms. You may have to inform, instruct others. But then it is you who is taking the responsibility to take the action. And that's the beauty of this statement. And here the Brahmana is saying, nAyam jano me, not this people. So it, my life is not something run by others' business. DevatA atma graha karma kala, not God's business, nature's business, karma's business, all that, throw it aside. The reason for joy and sorrow, manaparam kAraNam Amananti, the highest realization, body of knowledge. You see, you have body of knowledge. If it comes to physics, you have Richard Feynman, who has his body of knowledge. Then you have Stephen Hawking. He has put his body of knowledge. And Penrose, Roger Penrose, he was also a Nobel laureate, a cosmologist. He has his body of knowledge. So when you say physics, it is a body of knowledge contributed by these incredibly sharp minds. And they have added knowledge there. Likewise, the body of knowledge called Shruti has been contributed by the revelations of rishis. And the beauty is they don't claim the ownership of all this. They say it's a self-evident truth. We stumbled and discovered it. We didn't invent it. It was discovered by us. And it is something, knowledge is available. And we sort of tune into that channel and we discovered it. And so here, manav param kAraNam Amananti. The actual cause for my joy, sorrow, etc., finally boils down to my mind. And if I want to lead a life of a human being responsibly, which means I have the ability to respond, which means my mind has the ability to actually process what's happening around me so that it gives me the capability to make informed decisions, which at that point of time, I feel is the best possible route to take for achieving what I need or what my purpose is, you see. That's what is responsibility, isn't it? This was made very popular by one of the famous authors who wrote Seven Habits of Highly Successful People. Stephen Covey was his name. And I don't know if the book is still in vogue, but it was a big thing when we were all young engineers in the corporate world. But anyway, so he broke the word responsibility into ability to respond, responsibility. And that ability to respond comes when we don't react by blaming, but rather we process the information and not go into a comfort zone of trying to blame my stars or blame my time or blame my karma or blame my parents or blame my friends or my past or whatever. But I understand that I have the capability, ability to respond right now to the challenges I face. I take informed decisions based on my own knowledge base. I can tap into some experience of people who care for me and understand what I need to do now, etc. So all this is manas, mind, isn't it? So the cause for my sukha and dukkha is manaha. And says, Shruti, says our scriptures. And that's what this person realized. After going through a lot of adversity, after being beaten, University of Hard Knocks, as they say now, UHK, which is called life. So he realized that mind is the actual cause for my own joy and sorrow.